Welcome to the Operating System Lecture, Module 1, Part 3. In the previous lecture, we have studied about various computer architectures and the different types of operating systems used in these computers. The contents of Module 1, Part 3 lecture are, first we will see system calls, system programs. Then we will study the different operating system structures such as symbol structure and layered structure. Then we will be seeing about operating system kernel and shell. Now let us see what is system call. The occurrence of an event is usually signaled by an interrupt from hardware or software. CPU may be working always. Sometimes hardware may interrupt the CPU to do certain task. Hardware may trigger an interrupt at any time by sending a signal to the CPU, usually by the way of system bus. Now let us see what is system call. It is also called monitor call. Like hardware interrupt, software also may trigger an interrupt by executing a specific operation called system call. Usually, the hardware interrupt is called interrupt and software interrupt is known as system call. When CPU is interrupted, it stops the present task and immediately transfers execution to the location which contains the start address of the interrupting routine. On completion of the interrupt, CPU resumes the interrupted computation. System calls provide an interface to the services made available by an operating system. Usually, computer works in two modes, that are kernel mode and user mode. When OS runs in kernel mode, then it has complete access to all hardware resources. But when a program running in user mode, then that program has no direct access to the resources that are connected to the computer. But when a program running in kernel mode happens to crash, then the entire system would crash. That is one problem of kernel mode. But when the program running in user mode happens to crash, then the entire system would not crash. That is, user mode is a safe mode and kernel mode is privileged mode. If user need to access some resources, makes a call to operating system that switches from user mode to kernel mode, which is context switching. Such a call is called a system call. System call is a programmatic way in which a computer program requests to a service from the kernel of the operating system. These calls are generally available as routines written in C or C++. Let us see an example for a system call, that is copy one file content to another file content. The procedures involved in this task are, first step is to get the input file name. It requires a system call. Second step is write prompt to the screen. For that also requires another system call. Third is to accept the input from the user, that is the input file name, through the keyboard or using mouse click. Altogether, for getting the input file name, three system calls are required. And next is to get the output file name. For acquiring the output file name, it requires one system call. Again, it also requires to write a prompt on the screen. It requires again another system call, and then accept the input from the user, that is the output file name, through keyboard or through using browsing. So again, for getting the output file name also requires three
system call. And next task is to open the input file. If the file doesn't exist, then you have to abort. For that also system call is required. And next is to create the output file. It also makes a system call. And then if such a file is already existing, then you have to abort. It also requires another system call. And next is to read from the input file and write to the output file. This task will be put in a loop, that is, it keep on reading and writing until no more content in input file exists. And after completing the writing operation, close the output file and write a completion message to the screen. And then after the successful completion of the operation, terminate normally. And altogether, such a simple task requires around 15 system calls. Since several tasks done in a system, so around thousands of system calls executed per second. So hope now you have understood what is a system call and how does it work.
As we have seen, system calls are made by the program when it needs to access some resources. And these system calls are routine services of operating system. Following are some of the system calls related with process control. The first one is create. Create system call used to create a new process with a specified attribute. Next is delete. Delete system call used to destroy the designated process. And next is abort. It terminates the process possibly due to certain abnormal condition. And next is fork and join. And fork system call is used to split the program sequence, and join system call is used to merge the sequence of execution. And next is suspend. Suspend program system call used to suspend the running process indefinitely. And resume is the system call used to resume the target process which is suspended indefinitely. And next system call is delay. Delay system call is used to suspend a particular process for a specified time period. And other system calls used are to set and get level of privileges, priority, access rights, etc. The get attribute system call can be used to get the attribute of a particular process. And next, change priority system call can be used to change the priority of the existing processes. Now we will be seeing about what are the system call categories and what are the difference of these system call categories. Here are the five system call categories. First one is process control, second one file manipulation, third is device manipulation, fourth one information maintenance, and last one communications. Let us see the first category system call, that is process control. The process control, what we mean is the system call that are used for controlling the processes. We know that there are various processes running in our system and all these processes need to be controlled. Some of the system calls that control the process execution we have seen already. Here are some more examples. For example, when a process is running, it has to run and it has to terminate or halt either normally or abnormally. The end system call is used to halt the execution normally. An abort system call is used whenever an error is occurred during the process execution. Next is load and execute. Load means load a process and execute means execute a process. And next is create process and terminate process. Next system call is get process attributes, set process attributes. These system calls are used to get the attributes and to set the attributes such as priority, execution time, etc. Next is wait event and signal event system calls. Wait event is used for a waiting an event, and signal event call used to resume the waiting event. And the last one is allocate and free the memory. When a process needs to execute, memory should be allocated to it. And that process, when that process finishes execution, that allocated memory should be freed. These are done using these system calls. The second one is file manipulation system calls. These are the system calls used for managing the files. For example, we have create file and delete file. For that, we require file name and file attributes. Next, we have open and close system call. Next, we have read and write system call. Then, we have get file attributes and set file attributes system call. In the previous section, we have seen the system call details of a file copy process. The system calls used for file copy are fall under this file manipulation category. The third one is device manipulation. The device manipulation or device management system call are used to acquire additional resources needed for a running process. System call manages the resource accesses. The first one is request device and release device. The request device system call is used by the program whenever it needed a device. And after the resource usage, the program need to make a system call to release the device. And next is read and write. Next system call is get device attributes and set device attributes that are used to get the device attributes and to set the device attributes. And next is logically attach or detach devices. A device can be attached either physically or logically. What is physical attaching of the device? For example, when you plug in a USB drive into the system, it is physical attaching of the system. But when you attach the USB drive manually, then operating system will understand that the device is attached using the logical attach system call. Then you will see a message on the screen that a new device is inserted. That is with the system call it is happening. And similarly, when you want to detach a device, normally you will click on the eject button and then system will pop up a message that now you can safely remove the drive. So that is also a system call, that is detach device system call, logical detach system call made by the operating system. These are the examples related with the device manipulation system calls. Fourth one is information maintenance. All the information about our system must be maintained and managed. Example, get time or date, set time or date, or get system data or set system data, and get process, file and device attributes, as well as set process, file and device attributes. All these kinds of system calls are used to maintain the system information, and these are fall into the category of information maintenance. Last one is communication system calls, used for communication between processes. When the process execute, they may need to communicate each other. The system calls related to communication category are, first one is create, delete communication connection. When two processes need to communicate each other, they need to be a connection between the processes. That is, they need to create connection, and after the communication gets over, they need to delete the connection. This is done with the system calls create and delete. Next is send and receive messages. When the processes communicate, they may need to send and receive messages. This is done with send receive system calls. Next is transfer status information. That means when the processes communicate each other, the process may need to report each other. That is, whether they have completed the sending and receiving of messages or not. Next is, we have attach or detach remote devices. When a process need to attach or detach devices remotely, they need the communication system calls attach or detach. So these were the five major categories of system calls. Now let us see how a system call is implemented. Implementing system call requires a transfer of control from user space to kernel space, which involves some sort of architecture specific feature. In most systems, system calls can only be made from user space processes. While in some systems, for example OS/360 and successors, privileged system code also issues system calls. OS executes at the higher level of privilege and allows applications to request services via system calls. A typical way to implement this is to use a software interrupt or TRAP. Interrupts transfer control to the operating system kernel. So, software simply needs to set up some register with the system call number needed and execute the software interrupt. An interrupt automatically puts the CPU into some elevated privilege level and then passes control to the kernel, which determines whether the calling program should be granted the requested service. If service is granted, kernel executes a specific set of instructions to which calling program has no direct control, then returns privilege level to that of the calling program, and then returns control to the calling program. Now let us see typical system call implementation. As I told earlier, system call implementation involves architecture specific features. Let us see the RISC processor and CISC processor system call implementation. In RISC processor, set up some register with system call number needed and execute the software interrupt called TRAP, and then transfer the control to the operating system control. In CISC processors, instruction set contains system syscall instructions such as syscall and sysret, as well as sysender slash sysexist for AMD and Intel processors respectively. This instruction has fast control transfer instructions that are designed to quickly transfer the control to the kernel for a system call without the overhead of the interrupt. And next is Linux 2.5. In Linux 2.5 formerly used the instruction int instruction, where the system call number was placed in the EAX register before interrupt was executed. Next is Multics. In Multics, it uses an older mechanism called call gate. It allows a program to call a kernel function directly using a safe control transfer mechanism, which the operating system set up in advance. And next is IA64 architecture. It uses an ender privilege code, that is EPC instruction. The first 8 system call arguments are passed in registers and the rest are passed on the stack. Next is IBM system / 360 mainframe family. It uses supervisor call instruction, that is SVC, with the number in the instruction rather than in the register. It implements a system call for most of IBM OS and for all the system calls in Linux. In IBM OS, the program call, that is PC instruction, is used for newer facilities. In particular, PC is used when the caller might be in service request block, that is SRB mode. Now let us see the parameters passing methods in system call. There are 3 general methods that are used to pass parameters between a running program and the operating system. The first one is to pass the parameters into registers. Second one is to store the parameters in a table which is stored in a memory, and the table address is passed as a parameter into a register. Third method is to push the parameters onto the stack by the program and then pop off the parameters by the operating system. The figure shown here is a representation of the method passing of parameters as a table. Here the table address is X, which is stored in the register shown here, and the system call number 13 gets executed, and the parameters stored in the table will be, the address of that parameters will get from the register. The second topic of this lecture is system programs. Next is system programs. An important aspect of a modern system is a collection of system programs. In the previous lecture, we have seen where these system programs reside. In the computer system structure, the lowest level is hardware. On top of hardware, the operating system resides. On top of OS, we have system programs, and on top of the system program, we have application programs. Now let us see what are system programs. System program provide an environment, convenient environment for program development and execution. Some of these are simply user interfaces to system calls. Others are considerably complex. System programs can be divided into the following category. The first one is file management system programs. They manage to create, delete, copy, print, dump, etc. These system programs help in manipulating files and directories. Next is status information. This category system program asks the system for date, time, amount of available memory or disk space, number of users in the system, logging and debugging information, etc. Next is the file modification. File management deals with the outer level of the file, but file modification deals with the inner content. If you want to modify the file content, you need to execute the system program related with the file modification. Next one is programming language support. There are different programming languages. Your system must support these programming languages. Otherwise, system may not be able to compile or run the programs written in these languages. Therefore, compilers, assemblers, interpreters for each languages are the system programs falls under programming language support. Next is the program loading and execution. Once a program is compiled, it must be loaded into memory to execute. System may provide you with different levels of loaders and linkers in order to accomplish this task. Sometimes debugging systems for either high level languages or machine languages are needed as well. Hence, the system programs loader, linker, debugger are falls into category programming loading and execution. Now the last one is communication. These are the system programs that help in communications. These programs provide the mechanism for creating virtual connection among processes, users and computer system. It also allow the users to send messages to one another's screen, also to browse web pages and send electronic email messages, as well as to log in remotely or to transfer files from one machine to another. These are the system programs that help in communication. Now we have seen the main categories of system programs based on the task they perform. Hope you understood what is system program. This figure describes system program in the operating system hierarchy. The system program serves as part of the operating system. It traditionally lies between the user interface and the system calls. This image shows that system program as well as application program form a bridge between the user interface and the system calls. So far we have seen what is system call and system program and their categories. Now let us see what is the difference between these two. User program receives OS services through system call, while system program provide a convenient environment for program development and execution. System calls are calls made by applications or the processes for a particular execution of a code block. System program is the program that is running in the kernel space. System call is the API exposed from kernel space to user space. So your program running in user space calls to system program via API, which is called as system call. These are the programs that are used and required to run the system, that is machine, input-output devices and other connected peripherals. They are also known as system softwares. Now let us move to the third topic, that is kernel. Now let us have a detailed study about the kernel functionalities and the different kernel structures. As we know, a kernel is a computer program that is the heart and core of the operating system. The kernel has control over everything in the system. It is the most important part of an operating system. Whenever a system starts, the kernel is the first program that is loaded after the boot loader, because the kernel has to handle the rest of the thing of the system for the operating system. It is a bridge between the applications and the actual data processing done at the hardware level. It manages operations of computer hardware, most notably the memory management and the CPU scheduling. It also manages system resources and the communication between the hardware and the software components. There are three types of kernels structures. First one is monolithic kernel, which contains the entire operating system. Hence, it is a complex. It has a complex structure. And second one is the microkernel, which includes only basic functionalities. And third one is the modular kernel. The monolithic kernel and microkernel has their own advantages and disadvantages. And the disadvantages of these two are get eliminated in the modular kernel. The detailed functionalities and the advantages and disadvantages of these type of kernels has been discussed in the coming section. A monolithic kernel is an operating system architecture where the entire operating system is working in kernel space. Monolithic kernel tends to be larger than other kernels because they deal with so many aspects of computer processing and incorporate code that interfaces with many devices, I/O and interrupt channels and other hardware operators. The kernel provides CPU scheduling, memory management, file management and other operating system functions through system calls. As both the services, that is user services and kernel services, are implemented under same address space, this makes operating system execution faster. If any service fails, the entire system crashes, and it is one of the drawbacks of this kernel. The entire OS needs modification if user adds a new service. This figure shows the monolithic kernel architecture. The functionalities shown below the application and above the hardware, everything is packed into one level called kernel. Hence, it is called a monolithic structure. Next is microkernel. As we have seen, in monolithic kernel, all operating system services were packed into one level. That makes implementation and maintenance very difficult. To reduce kernel complexity, non-essential components were removed from the kernel and they are implemented as system and user level programs, which results the kernel size small. The main function of the microkernel is to provide communication facility between client programs and various services running in user space as message passing. The microkernel provides minimal process and memory management in addition to the communication facility. The benefit of using microkernel is the ease of extending the operating system. That is, whenever we want to add a new service, all the new services are added to user space, hence no kernel modification is required. Another benefit is the ease of portability. That is, new hardware designs can be made easily. It also provides more security and reliability. If a service fails, the rest of the operating system remains untouched. But in a monolithic structure, if a service fails, the entire system gets crashed. One of the disadvantages of microkernel is that the performance issue. It is due to the system overhead. This figure shows the microkernel architecture. As we can see, the layer on the top of hardware is the microkernel, which provides only few functionalities such as memory scheduling, process scheduling and basic inter-process communications. The rest of the operating systems such as device management, file management, etc. are included in the user space. Hence, this architecture provides better security compared with the monolithic structure. Now let us see the comparison of monolithic kernel with microkernel. First thing is size. The microkernel is small in size because the operating system functionalities are broken down into different layers. But monolithic kernel is larger compared with microkernel because in this structure everything is packed into one level. And next is regarding the execution speed. Microkernel execution is slow because the system call has to pass through all the layers one by one, hence the time required will be more. But in monolithic kernel, since everything is packed in one level, the execution will be faster. And next is extendability. Microkernel is easy to extend because if you want to add a new service, it can be added as a new level. But in a monolithic kernel, it is hard to extend because if you want to modify, the entire system need to be modified. And next is security. Microkernel is more secure compared to monolithic kernel because in microkernel, if a service crashes, it does affect on the microkernel, but all other functionalities will never touched. But in monolithic kernel, if a service crashes, the whole system will get crashed. And regarding the code, in microkernel, to write the microkernel, more code is required. But to write the monolithic kernel, it is easy to make the code. And the example for a microkernel are QNX, Symbian, L4 Linux, etc. The monolithic kernel examples are Unix, Linux, BSDs, OpenBSD, NetBS, etc. Third one is modular kernel. This kernel uses object-oriented programming technique to create a modular kernel. Here we have small core kernel which has core functionalities, and other functionalities are included as modules which will be loaded to the kernel either at boot time or at runtime. The various modules shown here are device and bus drivers, scheduling classes, file systems, loadable system calls, executable formats, stream modules, and miscellaneous modules. These modules are loaded to the kernel as and when required. The microkernel requires message passing. Unlike microkernel, modular kernel, each module can communicate directly to the kernel without passing through other modules, which improves the performance. This modular kernel provides easy debugging. Whenever an error occurs in one module, only that module need to be debugged. It also provides security. Whenever one module get crashed, only that module need to be touched. The entire system will never get crashed. Fourth topic of this lecture is shell. As we know, the operating system is divided into two sections, that is kernel and shell. In the previous section, we have seen the various types of kernels and their functionalities. And now let us see what is a shell and what are the different types of shells used. The shell acts as an interface between the user and the kernel. That is, it allows the user to communicate with the kernel. When a user logs in, the login program checks the username and password and then starts another program called the shell. OS shells use either a command line interface or a graphical user interface depending on a computer's role and particular operation. It interprets commands that the user types in and arranges further arranges it for carrying out the certain activities. It is named as shell because it is the outermost layer around the kernel. Now let us see what are the different types of kernels, shells. Based on the interface used, the shells are categorized into two. One is CLI shell and the other one is GUI shell. CLI shell uses command line interface in alphanumeric characters typed on a keyboard to provide instructions and data to the operating system interactively. CLI shells require user to be familiar with commands and their calling syntax and to understand concepts about shell specific scripting language. And next is graphical shells. It uses graphical user interface for allowing operations such as opening, closing, moving and resizing windows as well as switching focus between windows. GUI shells place a low burden on the computer beginners and it is easy to use also. Most GUI enabled operating systems also provide CLI shells. Now let us move to the last topic of this lecture, that is operating system structures. In the previous section, we have seen different types of kernels and shells. Now let us see what are the different OS structures. The structure of OS concerns the nature of OS core, that is kernel, and other parts of the operating system and their interaction. The first OS structure is simple structure. This is the structure used in the earlier days and it is not designed with a well structure. And the next one is monolithic structure. It is also a simple structure. In this structure, operating system formed as a single software layer between the user and the bare machine. User interface was provided by the command interpreter in this structure. Both command interpreter and user processes invoked OS functionalities and services through system calls. The disadvantage of this structure is that poor portability, high cost of maintenance and enhancement. The third structure is layered structure. In this structure, operating system is divided into number of layers. And the fourth one is modular structure. This is the best methodology in operating system design. As we have seen in modular kernel, this OS uses object-oriented programming technique to create the kernel. The details about this each structures are discussed in the next section. Now let us see the details about simple operating system structure. It is a small, simple and limited systems that do not have a well-defined structure. The figure shows the operating system structure of Microsoft Disk operating system. Here at the bottommost we have ROM BIOS device drivers, which is the base hardware. And then the top of this we have device drivers, then we have resident software system programs and then application programs. In this structure we can see that the device drivers have direct access to the basic hardware. Then resident system programs have direct access to the device drivers as well as the basic hardware. Then the application programs have the access to the system program as well as hardware. In this structure, all softwares have the direct access to the hardware. That is, the interfaces and levels of functionalities are not well separated. This looks like a layered structure, but we cannot call it as a layered structure because all these layers have access to the base hardware. The problem with this structure is that it is vulnerable to malicious programs. The system crashes when the user program fails because it is not well protected, well structured, and not well defined. Next, we will see another structure called monolithic structure. It is also a simple structure. This was followed by the Unix operating system. It is also a limited structure. This figure shows the Unix structure. This structure has two separable parts. On top, we have users, and below that, we have shells and commands, compilers and interpreters, and system libraries. Second part is the kernel. Everything below the kernel, a system call interface, and above the hardware is the kernel. Too many functions, such as signal terminal handling, character I/O system, terminal drivers, file system swapping, block I/O system, disk and tape drivers, CPU scheduling, page replacement, demand paging, etc., are packed into one level called kernel. Hence, this structure is called a monolithic structure. The original Unix OS has limited structuring, also had limited hardware functionality. The Unix OS consists of two separable parts, that is system program and kernel. System program use kernel supported system calls and provides the functions such as compilation, file manipulation, etc. The kernel is separated into interfaces and device drivers. It consists of everything below the system call interface and above the physical hardware. It also provides the file system, CPU scheduling, memory management, and other functions through system call. A large number of functions for one level is included. Hence, it is called a monolithic structure. And this makes the implementation and maintenance very difficult. If you want to add something into it, you have to modify the entire thing. If you want to debug something again, you have to touch everything. This is the disadvantage of monolithic structure. In order to solve the disadvantages of monolithic structure, OS developers have come up with another structure called layered structure. In this structure, the OS is divided into a number of layers, each built on top of lower layers. For example, the bottom layer, layer 0, is the hardware. Then we have layer 1, then we have layer 2, etc. And the topmost layer, layer N, is the user interface. Here we have broken down the functionalities into different layers and separate like this. With modularity, layers are selected such that each uses functions and operations of only lower level layers. The main advantage of this structure is easy to implement and debug. In order to solve the disadvantages of monolithic structure, OS developers have come up with another structure called layered structure. In this structure, the operating system is divided into a number of layers, that is levels, each built upon top of lower layers. For example, the bottom layer, layer 0, is the hardware. Then we have layer 1, then we have layer 2, etc. And the topmost layer, layer N, is the user interface. Here we have broken the functionalities into different layers and separate like this. With modularity, layers are selected such that each uses functions and services of only lower layers. The advantages of layered structure are First one, design and implementation of system is simplified. It also simplifies debugging and system verification. Because every layer is having different functionalities, so instead of keeping them together, they are separated into different layers. Whenever an error occurs in one layer, only that layer needed to be debugged. This is one of the advantages of layered structure. Also, layered structure, each layer hides the data structure, operations and hardware from higher layers, hence it ensures protection. The disadvantage of layered structure is that it is difficult in deciding the layer position, and also it is slow in getting the services because system call has to pass through all the layers one by one, hence more time required to process the services. This figure shows the various layers of computer system. The innermost layer is the hardware and the outermost layer is the users. Users interacts with the computer through various applications. The two sections of operating system shown here are shell and kernel. Shell accepts the user request for the certain services and passes it to the kernel. Kernel interacts with hardware to provide the requested services. This figure shows the various layers in the operating system. Lower layer is the hardware, on top of it process schedulers, then on top of it memory and IO device management layer, on top of it file system management, and the topmost layer in the kernel space is system services. On top of the kernel space is the user application. User application get the system services using system calls. The fourth operating system structure is the modular structure. A modular operating system is built with its various functions broken up into distinct processes, each with its own interface. The primary benefit of modular approach is that each process operates independently, and if one of them fails or needs an update, it won't affect any of the other functions. By contrast, in traditional monolithic operating system, if any one element or application fails or needs an update, the entire system must be shut down and restarted. The main elements of a modular operating system are a kernel and a set of dynamically loaded applications with their own discrete memory space. The kernel is protected from service and application failures. Each process can be monitored to determine if it is operating properly, and if necessary, a faulty process can be restarted dynamically. The overall system can continue to operate throughout. Linux kernel is modular, which means it can extend its capabilities through dynamically loaded kernel modules. The advantages of modular structure is that easy management, high availability and protection. Now let us summarize the lecture. An operating system is a software that manages the computer hardware as well as providing an environment for application programs to run. Perhaps the most visible aspect of an operating system is the interface to the computer system it provides to the human user. Both the shell and the kernel are the parts of this operating system. The main difference between kernel and shell is that the kernel is the core of the operating system that controls all tasks of the system, while the shell is the interface that allows the users to communicate with the kernel. We have studied the various types of kernels and shells used in the operating system. Then we have seen various operating system structures, such as symbol structure, monolithic structure and modular structure, and their advantages and disadvantages. This completes the module 1 of the operating system course. Thank you.